Hello, I'm Robin Whalley, welcome to Lenscraft. In a previous video, I explained how the blending ranges feature worked in Affinity Photo. You'll need to understand blending ranges for today's video. If you didn't see the previous video, I'll include a link in the description below. In today's video, we're using blending ranges in Affinity Photo to do some luminosity blending. If you're an Adobe Photoshop user, you may have done something similar using luminosity masks. To demonstrate this, I'll use two versions of an image which I've processed from the same RAW file. One image is a dark exposure where I reduce the exposure and contrast. The other is much brighter because I increase the exposure slider, but I reduce the highlights to recover the blown out areas. What I want to do is create a single image which gives me the best of both of these images. I'll select the light layer first because it's on top in the Layers Studio panel and it gives me much more control in the Blending Ranges dialog. When I open the Blending Ranges dialog, I'll first take a minute to understand the effect of the two control grids on this image. If I use the Source Layer grid, the blending will be based on the light layer. In that layer, you can see there's a large portion of the image that's light. When I move the white point down to set the opacity to zero, it allows a large portion of the darker layer beneath it to show through. This also kills the contrast in the image because there are bright tones across the entire frame in that layer. If instead I use the grid for the underlying composition, the blending becomes based on the tones in the dark layer. You can see the dark layer has very few bright areas in comparison to the light layer. When I move the white point down to zero opacity, the brightest tones from the dark layer start to show through. This produces a nicer result and retains more of the local contrast in areas like the rocks. Now, I'll check the black points. On balance, I think I prefer the results from the source layer. Based on what I've seen, I can set the black and white blending points for both of these layers. I'll also include a midpoint adjustment to each grid, then move it around to achieve a nice balance of the tones. After doing this, you may find that you need to tweak the black and white points. I'm also going to remove the linear option to smooth out the blending a little bit more. Now, despite all the power of these blending ranges, there's still some areas of this image where I'd like to see more of the dark layer. Now, if I tried to do that using the blending options dialog, it would affect other areas of the image, and I don't want to do that. Instead, I'm going to add a mask to the lights layer. I'll now paint on that mask using a soft black brush set to a low opacity. By painting the shadow area of the rock, it darkens the area by hiding the light layer. This allows you to see more of the dark layer below it. Now this example used two versions of an image processed at different exposures, but you can use it as the basis for other adjustments, like changing the color temperature in certain areas. This is a very powerful photo editing technique called double raw processing. You process the same raw file twice, but with different settings. You then use luminosity blending to bring them together. I'll be demonstrating double raw processing with some other photo editors in future videos. You can find the finished image from today and from my other videos on Instagram. I'll include the link in the video description below. If you enjoyed this video, please share it and don't forget to subscribe. I'm Robin Whalley, you've been watching Lenscraft. I'll see you next week for another video.